I'm gonna miss you, man. I hope Cali does you good. And you always got a home here, man.
You're the only magician I'm friends with, so I'm gonna miss that.
Gonna miss you. I'm sure everyone will. It's crazy.
I'm really proud of you.
You're the man, and I'll see you soon. I will definitely be visiting you this year.
I don't hope, I know you'll succeed in California, brother.
You're in California now. Don't get shot by black people. No, you're afraid of black people. Don't become a drug addict. Don't get an STD. Don't get anybody pregnant.
I love you. Good luck, because you're gonna need it. No, you're not. You're gonna be good. You'll be fine. Gold. I love you.
Don't ever come back. You know, maybe come back to visit, but don't ever come back to move here. It's your home now, and I know you can do it out there, so I love you so much, bro.
Lately, I've been losing sleep, dreaming about the things that we could be. But baby, I've been praying hard. Said no more counting dollars, we'll be counting stars. Yeah, we'll be counting stars.
If I really loved magic, why would I reveal it? I never intended or wished to be well known for magic. At one point, there was nothing more I wanted than to disassociate myself entirely from magic.
Rip the earth in two with your mind.
All anyone wants in life is to feel important, and that's why the people who get into magic dive so deeply into it. It gives them the ability to be someone they're not, and to feel important, and to get people to like them. Magic is the only art form that you can do to gain people's admiration, respect, envy, and love by deceiving them. Magicians are professional liars. I wanted to manipulate cards. I wanted to cheat and be able to do something under someone's eyes that they didn't know what I was doing right in front of them, and say I was doing one thing when I was really doing another. The whole art of manipulation really appealed to me.
All right, what is Evan's greatest strength?
He's really good at telling stories.
I remember they got their first computer and they were at their old house and they were in the basement and Evan was down there and he was typing on the computer and he had a list of things and I remember looking over his shoulder and say, what is that? And he says, oh, these are all my stories. I said, what do you mean stories? And they were story titles. And I said, so you've written all these stories? He said, no, but I'll tell you the story. And the one story that always stood out in my head was the shoes that ate the people's feet. And it was this whole story about this pair of shoes that when people would put on, they ate their feet. And here's this, I don't know, 4 or 5 or 5 or 6 year old kid with, it was over 100 story titles, you know, and he was going to be a storyteller. And, you know, so he had that focus to put those things together and organize that stuff.
I think Evan's greatest strength is his discipline. Like his discipline to work on his channel, his discipline to do P90X instead of going out on a Friday or Saturday night. He's just got this strict discipline that he never ever breaks from.
If someone feels that they can't do something in their life, I think he would always try to talk them into, why not? Like, why not do what you want to do and shoot for your dreams and your goals?
When it comes to public speaking, I can't do it. So when I see Evan doing it like pretty well, like very well, I just, like, the way he communicates, talks to people, That's his strength. That's his greatest strength, in my opinion.
Be able to connect with people, like, just like right there on the spot.
Probably his charisma. He's very charming. He's very sly. Very, I guess, mysterious.
It's got to be his mind.
His mind. He's got strong will. You can he can get beaten down and beaten down and beaten down, and he will always come back up on top.
When he wants something, he makes it happen. He doesn't make excuses and he doesn't talk about how he's going to do it. He just does it.
He's determined. He's always determined. He doesn't let anyone talk him out of things.
Out of anyone that I've ever seen, he's pushed himself to have what he has more than anyone.
He wants something. He will have it.
He's going to do whatever it takes to get it.
As I rack my brain right now, I cannot think of anything of recent at all. Or going back and when he first got into magic way back in middle school, that he just likes to set goals and he likes to get goals and he likes to finish them off.
He really helped me with my card magic.
I learned almost everything I know from like Jarek. It's just amazing what he does, and it actually inspired me to kind of start doing what he's doing and actually start my own YouTube channel.
He's really like inspired me to like want to improve more at magic and become the best I can be at it.
Basically gotten me to be a better person.
Being a positive role model. That in itself is so rare.
When I was 12 or 13, my friend Mike Budson showed me a magic trick in my basement. Basically all it was the six of hearts was on the bottom. He's like, take any card as long as it's the six of hearts. All right. Take any card as long as it's the two of diamonds. Okay. Okay, now I'm going to pick the king of spades. He goes through the deck, and we're left with our three cards. That was it. I was just like, whoa, you're my magic? It just, I don't know, it gave me a feeling of like superiority, of like, I know something that you don't.
When I was in high school, I saw this kid doing magic, and I'm like, wow, he must be lonely because he has a lot of time to do magic by himself. I'm gonna go play Pokemon because that's what I did at the time and still do. And I just saw Evan doing this magic stuff trying, and I was just like, he's really desperate for friends, obviously, because he just has to do things to impress these people.
I feel like the only people I've ever met that did magic were really nice, really outgoing, but also shy at the same time. Like they didn't know how to put themselves out there. So if you have something really cool to show a group of people, they're way more willing to be like, oh, hey, this guy's awesome. Like, let's talk to him.
There's not many magicians out there. It is growing, but compared to other hobbies like music or sports, you know, it's definitely a minority. So there's an appeal in being kind of exclusive and being one of the only guys who can do what you do. On a deeper level, I would say magic can affect people on an emotional level that other hobbies or art forms can't really do. It's a very unique feeling that you get when you're shocked or curious or amazed, you know. We don't get that feeling very often anymore, but magic brings that out.
I like to fantasize, and that's part of being human, I feel like, is knowing that even though some things aren't real, it can be if you want them to, even though it's not technically real.
He likes to rub up on guys, and I don't blame him. Let me start that over.
Wrestling's got a bit of disbelief to it as well. Like wrestling's different from UFC, because wrestling has stories. It has bad guys and good guys.
For our generation, that was, wrestling was a thing, man. That was back when we actually had good wrestlers. It was the people to love, good people to hate. John Cena didn't win every pay-per-view, miraculously.
If you capture the fans correctly, like, the response is unreal. Like, people just completely freak out.
The feeling you need to tell a story, and it is, and unlike other theater, you're telling a story literally with your body. So not only do you feel it with your mind, but you literally feel it with your body, and getting other people to be like, ooh and ah with something that you're doing to yourself.
It's just got this appeal to it with the story. You get sucked up in this story and you want the good guy to win.
When I was 8 years old, I went over to my friend Chris's house to play soccer in his backyard. It was a cold day in Michigan, so Chris came out wearing a bright orange ski mask. And my friend Corey, who was over, said to him, oh my gosh, you look like Rey Mysterio. And I was like, who's Rey Mysterio? So that's when I went home and watched WCW for the first time. The first wrestling thing I've ever saw. Turn on the TV, Diamond Dallas Page power bombs Booker T off the ramp through a table, and I was just like, oh my god, like, these humans shouldn't be able to do that to each other. I flip over to Monday Night Raw, and the first wrestling match, full match that I saw was The Rock versus Triple H for the WWF Championship in a steel cage match. So that was in 1998, so I came into wrestling at like the peak of the Attitude Era. And it was the best time to be a wrestling fan. And I just fell in love. And I started wrestling on my basement floor when I was 8 years old. My parents had a video camera, and I would always borrow it and film stuff. And we'd have like these makeshift ladder matches and these Hell in a Cell matches using screen doors. When I was 13, I was still filming. And I made a backyard wrestling promotion, and it was called the XWF, Extreme Wrestling Federation.
Backyard wrestling on the trampolines. Holy schmoly. A mother's nightmare, but they were out there religiously, rain, snow, sleet, sunshine, with chairs and my trampoline that I bought with my babysitting money. Ruined it with his wrestling.
I don't know, it became his life for years.
You were just having fun. Why am I breaking up fun for kids?
We just do a ton of backyard wrestling, and I'd film it, and then Kermit pirated video editing software for me. So I started learning how to edit videos. I would upload these music video wrestling matches that we did for XWF, and at one point, you could type in backyard wrestling on YouTube, and like 70,000 videos would come up, and if you sorted it by rating, that's when they had the 5-star rating still, like 17 out of the top 20 videos were videos of XWF and videos that I edited. So I knew we were like doing a good job, both with like the storytelling of the video editing and the actual wrestling, to be entertaining enough. So when we were doing all this backyard wrestling, I would be watching other videos of other backyard wrestlers. And there was one that guy that called out to me, his name was Combination Combat Kid, KKK. And around that same time, it was the summer of 2007, we had a guy named Justin, Johnny Margera at the time, come out and wrestle for us, with us. He came up to me one day and said, how would you like to wrestle in a real ring, in front of real people, every single week? So that's when I went to BCWA. And the first day at BCWA, I went with Eric, and we're getting there, and Justin's just like, you won't believe this, KKK is here, Combination Combat Kid. And I see him, I was actually starstruck. And it turns out, you know, KKK, I thought internet personality, internet like celebrity, this guy also lived in Michigan. And it's it turned out that it was Jason Brewer.
The first thing I'd hoped for is that they would get like real refs. Because this one ref that they had was just a terrible, terrible ref. Can't remember, I think it was like Victor. In my mind, it was him following a passion that he wanted to do. Heck, he was 17 years old.
That's the way he wanted to spend his Sunday afternoons, and he wanted to learn the ropes, and if you're going to learn the ropes, you got to put in the time. And I think he's always understood, you're going to have to learn something and learn it well. Don't pick it up in 1 minute. It takes you months, years to pick it up. He's willing to listen, he's willing to travel, he's willing to go places and put the time in order to learn what it is to be a good wrestler.
I think I was more nervous about him going out to California than I was having him go into wrestling.
When we were 15, Eric, Kermit, and like 12 of our other friends would always sneak out and come to 7-Eleven. One night we snuck out, and Kermit invited Lindsey out, and that's how I met Lindsey Dodd.
I've met Ree through me. She is really close to us at the time. She lives like 3 streets from here. I mean, I don't know. It's like when they met, you just knew.
His ex-girlfriend, Ree, is probably one strong weakness just because of the fact that they were together for 5 years, and Ree is just that one girl that will probably never ever leave Evan's mind. I wouldn't doubt it that he still thinks of her now and then.
I did overhear recently that he moved away to get away from a girl.
It was tough on both of us, and to get away was probably, I think we both needed it.
I told my wife, I said, man, I tell you, if I was at that age again, I'd do the same thing. You know, but my reasons would probably differ from his.
Evan went to California to get away from an ex-girlfriend. That's what he told me, so he could move on, because that was a tough breakup. But I feel like there was more behind that.
I think there's two reasons. I think the biggest reason
was because of his ex-girlfriend and him needing to kind of set himself apart and do bigger and better things and prove to her and everyone else that he was better than everyone, you know, back home. But I think another, you know, another reason is because he did genuinely like want to get big at wrestling and magic.
He needed a fresh start. I know he needed to get away from certain influences, bad influences. And I think he feared that his friends were not going places or not going anywhere and they were stuck. And one of his biggest fears is to become stagnant and just wallow in the same boring, mundane things day in and day out.
You see enough people circling the drain, like you gotta get away to make a way.
He went there on a vacation with our friend C. Kardynal, and I think he just loved it. I asked him about it when he came back, and he's like, it's everything I've ever wanted. And he saw Michigan as a place of nothing, and it really is. It's just nothing. That's why I'm gonna be here forever, because I'm nothing.
I think that someone sent him on his way, in a great way, though.
It's just a huge bonus that it happens to be completely clear across the United States, and what better way to get away from an old relationship that is just gonna continue to weigh on you than to actually dip the hell out.
It's like the best thing that could have happened for him, because like had he stuck it out and sat around, maybe he never would have did P90, maybe he never would have had the channel blow up, maybe obviously wouldn't have moved to California because he'd still be kicking in Michigan with his arm around some chick in a movie, you know, for like the third time that week.
You know, and sometimes heartbreaks like that that are so painful to go through and we're going through them, sometimes they're some of the best things that happen to us.
Here, check this out. Like, if I take that, watch my shoe. This is what I'm gonna try to do. This is like this technique that I learned how to do.
And it reties itself.
Just like that.
Get out of here.
Yeah, just like that.
How did you do that?
It's like in video games when you go like left, up, down, right.
Right.
It's just like a certain pattern. It took me.
Tie your freaking shoe back.
It took me.
Get out of here! I just saw it.
It took me 6 years to learn that pattern, but like.
I just saw your shoe. I just saw this guy tie his shoe without. Get dude. Oh, fucking not. Hey, dude, he just tied his shoe and he didn't even bend down to tie it. Look at the shoe's tied now. Unreal. I just saw magic right there, dude.
I just saw this man tie his shoe without bending down tying his shoe. Now, I've seen things, I've seen jokes, but I've seen pranks, but I've seen his shoe tied. The second time I looked down, the man didn't even bend down.
A magician is never supposed to reveal his secret, how he did the trick.
I didn't know that was the magician's code until I met Evan.
Revealing the magic trick doesn't mean that it turns out to be something really easy. It's still the whole process of getting through to it. It's just, how do you do that?
I don't really like the term reveal. I mean, reveal means you're just giving away the secret just for the sake of giving it away. I prefer teaching magic.
It's just a good icebreaker that kids can use to overcome a fear that they have of maybe meeting someone new, or what are they gonna do? How are they gonna be cool? They can use these tricks and really move forward socially with their lives.
A lot of magicians coming up today might not even like know this, these tricks existed.
You know, when you're growing up or when you're a teenager, you don't really have money to spend on these DVDs, these book sets, which are expensive.
He wants kids who've gone through the same things that he has to have an easier way out.
From what I've read on his web pages, he's got people around the world that are thanking him for giving them confidence.
If it hadn't been for, you know, Jarek and him revealing some tricks, then, you know, my life would still not be pretty awesome.
It can really take like a beginner magician like all the way up to like an intermediate like magician just like that.
Some do it because they want the mystery there. They want to be like, oh, look it, I have something that you don't know how to do, so that makes me mysterious and cool. But then, like for Evan, he does it because he wants to teach people. He wants to help people be as good at magic as he is. And I think that's way more admirable than the fact that people don't want to show their tricks and that they're like, no, you can't do magic either.
The first time I saw him doing it, I was like, oh, that's cool. Like, you know, if I wanted to learn how to do this, I could.
The thing about Jarek is it's not like he reveals any like big tricks like dress code or pressure.
He doesn't give the good ones away. He never gives the good ones away.
it's not just how it's done, it's a tutorial on the pattern, you know, and practicing for hours in front of a mirror. Like, it's super important. It's not just like knowing how the trick is done, but it's knowing how to perform the trick for aspiring magicians to be.
There's no secrets. It's going to get out one way or the other, whether he did it or not, you know, but I think he wants to give back and have people see the same successes that he has.
Once he's done, there's got to be someone else to come take his place.
I think Evan's always been about going against the grain. You know, if society thinks you need to be one thing, or if there's a rule generally accepted by a lot of other people, Evan will probably want to break that rule.
Hi. Hi. Go ahead and pick any card that you want. Free choice.
Free choice?
Yeah.
Any card I want.
Yeah.
Let's just go with the Ace of Spades.
You want the Ace of Spades?
The Ace of Spades.
Oh,
there it is right there.
Perfect.
Ooh, wow.
Sign the face of the card, but write it big. Sign, like, as big as you can.
Oh,
like
sure,
a,
sure.
Like a canvas.
Hi.
Can I go sideways?
Signature, letters. Yeah, perfect. Take up as much of the card as you can.
Just sign it.
Perfect.
I got a little on my finger.
Perfect.
Is that okay?
Yeah, that's fine. So we know... I would. You know what? And Ty, you want to give it a nice, like, overhand shuffle?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Like this right here?
Yeah.
Here we go, like that.
Evan, perfect. I love when you do magic.
Thank you. So, what we're going to do is we're going to actually take this over to the hot tub.
Oh my god. Get on that butt.
Don't get the car.
So check it out, everyone. Ace of Spades.
That's right. Here's the sign.
Hot tub, hot water, and cards don't mix. Right?
No. Watch. Oh God.
Take it out. Watch.
Oh, it's gonna be crazy. It's gonna be crazy.
Whoa.
What are you doing? You're ready for
it. Don't worry about it. Hi. You remember that card you signed?
It was an Ace of Spades. Yes.
They're not even there!
They just up and vanished. Well, out of nowhere.
You guys, I can't handle it.
They're not even there. I'm pissed. Burn on it.
Woo!
Come
on!
Is Bicycle making you your own deck? Because this is, like, pretty much how to serve reality.
I know, I wish. I've been wanting to make my own deck, but I'm not going to make it unless it's really, really cool. Yeah. I want the King of Hearts to have, like, a white patch in his eyebrow.
Oh, that would be cool.
Evan has this blonde eyebrow, like this blonde little streak right here.
It's his wisdom patch.
It's fucked up. I don't know what happened.
I'm pretty sure it spread to his beard and mustache, too, so you should probably acknowledge that as well.
Yeah, when he first moved out here, it wasn't like that.
I think it's fake. I saw in the video once that it was like natural. I don't know if I believe that because I've never seen anything like that before.
I mean, we can come up with like a few like ideas. I mean,
he was dyeing his hair one day, or you know, highlighting, you know, and he just slipped and like hit his eyebrow. And was like, hey, just go with this. This is gonna be my new thing.
Maybe it rubbed off getting too close to Evan's good friend, Stephen Beffrey.
For the good of humanity, kill yourself before the eyebrows go completely white.
I think that's from my side of the family, as most of my uncles were very gray very early on in their lives.
Unless he is keeping it secret and he paints it each day or whatever, I don't really know. But
very sexy. Girls probably love it.
Dude, you have to end your life.
Strangely enough, for him works, for his line of magic and for what he likes to do. I think it fits that persona of having a strange eyebrow to look at.
I hope I don't get one of those. Not that it looks bad on Evan, but it does look bad on Beffrey.
Welcome to the club, man. God help you.
Oh, you're gonna throw it away? Did you want a Coke? Huh? Did you want one or a Coke?
No.
Here, what? I'll throw it away. Here, look. Oh, go ahead, bro. Here, look. Look, look. Wait, watch. Take it. You can actually see it starts to uncrush itself. Yeah. Look, did I take it? You want it? Test it out. Test it out. Try it. You Coke?
That's cool.
That's crazy.
Did you see that shit? Flatten the can on the sides. Set it down on the ground. Dude comes up, picks it up, and he fucking has four Coke, and he fucking goes like this, and the fucking dents come out. Then he rubbed the top, and the top came back open, closed, and there was nothing in it, and now there's Coke in it.
Cheers. I'm good, but thank you.
How the hell did you do that? That's fucking cool, bro.
It's just a skill I picked up after it was like 10 years of yeah. It's good. Just a skill.
That's true, dude.
You like that?
I did like that. That was cool.
Yeah, enjoy it.
Yeah?
Yeah, enjoy it. It's like, it's yours. Thank you.
I know Evan, and I'll tell you, the way he got good at magic is when he puts his heart into something, he goes at it 100%. And Evan, he knows how to study.
He works his ass off.
Practiced. A lot. Every day.
Repetition, over and over and over and over again.
Perfect practice makes perfection.
He performed a lot. He did the same trick over and over again to a bunch of different people.
In front of your parents, in front of your friends, in front of people you've never met, on the bus, on the playground, you know, it didn't matter.
Anything that you want to be good at, you got to do over and over again. You're going to fall on your ass, you're going to suck, you're going to fuck up, but you're going to keep doing it. Whatever, you'll get better. Every day gets a little bit easier.
I do believe that his failures is what propelled him to drive himself a lot harder.
He's got an ability to focus on minute detail and perfect those tiny little details and things. You know, and he does it in not only magic, but he does it with his wrestling, he does it with his film and his photography. You know, he just has that uncanny knack to focus in on those small little details and perfect them.
The hardest thing for an upcoming magician is, what do I say to someone to interact with them, like break the ice and show them magic? It doesn't matter what you say as long as you say something. The weather is nice today, don't you think?
Yeah, it's pretty nice.
Good. So pick a card.
We got time?
It's before the light changes color. All right, got memorized? Do you have a condom? Because I'm about to mind fuck you.
Alright, how's this work?
Can I show you a magical time?
I'm okay.
Before the light changes?
Okay.
Alright, check it out. I'm performing magic to pay for karate lessons because my parents were kidnapped by ninjas!
Pick a card.
Look at me! Would you please pick a card?
No.
Would you please pick a card?
Hello.
What's up, my name is, you wanna see some magic?
Do it.
Sure.
Take one. May I blow your
horn?
Mind with magic?
Okay.
Alright, check it out. Here, go like this so you can hold the card, right? Hey you, I'm an ex-bomb expert and I'm about to blow your mind! Take one before the light changes color.
Okay.
Nice.
What? How did you do that? That was really impressive.
Thank you very much. How do I just go up and show someone magic? It doesn't matter what you say as long as you say something. Growing up, I was this unattractive kid, I'll just say. The only things I liked were magic and wrestling, So I got made fun of a lot. It was a pretty easy target.
Evan came home one day and he had been talking suicide. We know that he had been depressed for quite a while. I didn't know to the extent that he was being bullied. So all we could really do was just sit him down and talk to him and reassure him how much he's loved. Basically, my standard answer to kids when they talk about suicide is that you're not taking these people with you into your future. You're not marrying them. You have to rise above it and just be happy with yourself, because in the end, it's you and yourself. You came into this world by yourself, you're leaving this world by yourself, and you're responsible for making yourself happy. And just know that we're here to love him and to cherish him, and he's my baby. And I think the breaking line was I told him that they'd have put me in the nut house if he did anything to him, because I could not survive without him in this world.
Though it's sad to say, things like that can get you pretty far.
It will form you into somebody that can overcome more obstacles in life than the people that have it easy in their life, and they can just kind of like walk through everything, and then they hit an obstacle and they just shut down, and like that's it for them.
Unfortunately, a lot of these kids nowadays are just like, he called me gay, and then they kill themselves. I mean, I'm sure there's a lot of things going on for them, but that's what the news and everything like puts out there, that just like, this person was bullied to death. They murdered themselves. I mean, you can't say that. Bullying's not, I guess it can make people kill themselves, but you know what? It makes people stronger, in my opinion. And it makes people better people, and they are better for what happened to them in their lives.
Pain is inevitable. Suffering is optional. We are all going to experience some kind of physical, logical, emotional, spiritual pain multiple times in many facets throughout our life as we grow older. There's nothing that we can do to stop the pain from coming or happening. But how you react to it, whether you want to turn that negative into a positive and use it to better yourself, better your life, or take a darker path, that's your decision. Pain is inevitable, suffering is optional.
Anyone who's going to achieve anything worth achieving is going to have circumstances that they're going to have to rise above.
If you got a dream, you're going to hear so many people go like, that's kind of dumb, that's stupid. You got to rise above that. Otherwise, you're going to get dragged down with them and go like, yeah, you're right, it's dumb. And then keep working your 9-to-5. Like, no. You got to be better than the people telling you like, that's dumb.
I've always told my students to rise above the crap, the garbage, just the shit that goes on in the world, and just be your own self, because if you're not happy with yourself and you can't rise above life's bumps in the road, you're doomed to fail.
Rise above means stay true to your morals, no matter what they are. You know, everyone has different morals. Everyone thinks something's good, and someone might think something's bad, and you know, someone don't agree with that, but that's their morals, and that's what that means.
I think rise above derived from my father. He would give me one piece of advice growing up. He said it all the time. It was the only advice I really remember that stuck. He said, be a leader, not a follower. So growing up, I would see my friends and other kids and people like smoking cigarettes and drinking alcohol. And I was just like, everyone's doing that. Like, that's being a follower. Why would I follow into that? My dad always said, be a leader. So I automatically assumed, you know, do the opposite of what most people were doing.
It can mean rise above your circumstances. It can be rise above adversity. It can be rise above your past.
It is so open to interpretation. People will make it mean whatever suits them at that particular instant in their life.
I think those words are pretty powerful, you know, rise above drugs, hate, bullying, alcohol, any negative things in life.
Don't let your demons hold you down.
Turn all the obstacles you have into opportunities.
Do something that no one else has already done.
Being one of a kind.
Keeping your head out of the garbage. You know, things that are getting in your way, things that are impeding on getting your goals done or whatever. You need to rise above all that stuff. You got a bully bouncing on your back or people telling you you can't get things done or whatever. Rise above encompasses anything that's getting in your way of what you're trying to accomplish in life.
You want to see where victory was snatched from the brink of defeat. Those are the stories that people like to see, and to me, that's what Rise Above means. It means that there was a chance that you may not have achieved your victory because of circumstances that were surrounding you, but you managed to pull everything together and eke the victory out.
Hey, Steven. We made a wrong turn at Albuquerque. We're lost. We have no idea where to go. What's going on? Nice to meet you. How you doing?
Good.
Good? What are you doing? You playing around?
Yeah, I was watching one of my videos.
You were watching one of my videos? Did you learn anything new? The
false cut.
The false cut? You know where we drove from to come see you? California. I'm just going to ask you a few questions, and your answers are going to be numbers, and we're going to multiply all these numbers together to try to come up, hopefully, some kind of clue as to someone who would be a good match for you.
Okay.
How old were you when you had your first kiss?
16.
13.
Times, how on a scale of 1 to 10, how good was it? 10 being the best.
It wasn't that good.
like
a rough
four.
One. Four. On a scale of 1 to 10, how good of a kisser do you think you are?
Oh, I'm definitely a 10.
10.
Love it. How many hours would you say in your entire life that you spent kissing?
23 now, so it's been 10 years. It's been a couple hours.
I guess like 200 hours?
200?
163.
163. How many days has it been since your last kiss?
April, May, June, 3 months ago.
3 months, so 90 days or so?
Yeah, it hasn't even been a day.
So how many hours has it been since your last kiss?
2 days ago.
2 days. Hit equals on the calculator. So I took all those numbers, 14, 8, 10, for how good of a kiss you are, multiply them together, and got this crazy 3,100,000,000,000 number, right? I was looking for a clue. This looks like it could be a phone number. Open your phone and dial in this number to see if it's one of your contacts. Is it?
No.
Oh, and it's not a contact, but it is a number.
It is a number.
Call it, and hopefully it's a real number. Hopefully it's a guy, and just tell them, I mean, if it's a girl, even too. Just tell them, leave a voicemail, whatever you have to do to say, I think we're meant to kiss. I think you're supposed to be my next kiss.
Oh,
do it.
God.
Right now?
Yeah. Chances are it's not a real number, but it could be. All numbers related to you.
It's ringing.
Okay. Arlington, Texas.
It's your phone number?
That's so lame.
I'm in San... I'm supposed to be your next kiss?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
How many girls have done this?
You're the first one.
You know, when I first met Evan, he wasn't as confident, honestly.
I know the first person you walk up to, stranger on the street, you gotta feel a little bit tense, but after you do it 50 times, 100 times, 1,000 times, you get better at it, and you get more comfortable at it, and that's kind of where he's at right now. You gotta start somewhere.
Even if he didn't want to do it, he just threw himself out there into the crowds, into the sharks, and said, I don't care. I don't care if I'm scared. I'm going to do it. I'm going to walk up to this person. I don't care if they're going to be mean to me, but he just didn't give a shit.
It was almost like a day-night type transition, really. One day he was, you know, just the old Evan before that, and the next day he would just go up to girls, talk to girls, be super comfortable with girls, and... You know, be like, hey, my name is Evan, what's your name? And, you know, before you know, he's getting numbers left and right. So, I'm guessing it's practice, but that was way too fast to practice, really.
The way he definitely improved on talking to girls in general was he listened and watched videos and audios of this one guy, David D'Angelo, who was basically a motivational speaker for guys to improve their dating with women and how to interact with them.
Some people get math. I feel like I just get magic. But my confidence, that was something I had to consciously work on. Going into eighth grade, I had no friends, and I came across a guy named David D'Angelo. He had the ability to teach guys how to interact with girls, and I was just like, oh wow, I have a problem with that, so like, I'd love to learn that. That did not come easy. I put time into learning how to act like I was confident.
I don't think learning pickup or something like that is bad per se, you know. I've had a few of my friends be like, you know that pickup shit that you do, Casey? Like, that's creepy. No, dude, like, not knowing how to talk to girls is creepy. Like, that's weird. Like, if you're just gonna sit somewhere and just stare at a girl, you know, dude, that's creepy. Like, learning how to talk to girls is not creepy at all.
A lot of the things I say in my Rise Above speech are things I learned from David D. Yes, the report is finally done. First the coffee, then the traffic. Man, this day is going downhill faster than I anticipated. I am so fired.
Let's get that DiGiorno one. Oh. The garlic bread pizza.
Not tell our boss this. Please.
Do not tell our boss.
You promise that we could be fired.
I'm feeling really good. Just got the, you know.
I just got over that migraine. I'm so fighting.
Nice bikes, fellas. Nice rides. Can't wait to get one with my bonus coming up. Yeah. I am so fired. All of my papers that took me 2 months to finish. Stay cool. You guys stay cool, okay?
Being on the internet, being a YouTuber, there's a lot of things we keep to ourselves. Not a lot of things, but there's some things we don't, like, put into the public eye.
You know, Evan has the little cockiness to him, the dick persona. I think that comes out. I think that comes out in his YouTube channels. I think he is who he is, honestly.
Evan thinks too much of himself.
I feel like Evan used to hold himself to the standard that he's perfect.
Do you see what I mean?
What were you guys talking about?
I'm like, your boyfriend's self-absorbed. She's like, how do you figure? And I was like, come here.
Casey likes to say that Evan Cloyd is Jarek 120's biggest fan.
He likes to be liked, and he'll do just about anything to get that. He always wants to be the center of attention. He wants to be the guy. And when he's not, he's sad or he's angry or he's pissed off.
Evan's got a temper.
Well, everyone's got an angry side. I know Evan's got it, and it's Evan likes Evan's way.
I was a mean kid back in the day. I really didn't tolerate much crap from anyone who was giving me crap. When you're getting picked on, if you show that it's, you're being affected by it, then that's what's going to cause more of it. I got violent sometimes. I got confrontational, but that comes with the territory of being a kid who's getting picked on.
When Evan was younger, he would take personally things that people would do to him, but then again, who wouldn't? When he was bullied, he would think to get revenge, always. The solution was always revenge, and I remember that. He always wanted to get even with anybody who ever screwed him over, made him feel bad. He had to do something back. And it had to be something worse than what they did to him.
One day, I was walking through the halls, and this kid named Matt was walking behind me, and he did this thing where, as soon as I'd lift up my foot, he'd kick underneath my foot, so I'd get this like jagged step. So I mean, there comes a fine line where it's just like, you know, you're gonna let someone belittle you or just, you know, stand up for yourself and show them that you're not someone to mess with. So I turned around and I smacked the shit out of them. And I got these giant monster freak hands. Even back then, my hands were ridiculously big. So he never bothered me again, and somehow I didn't get in trouble for it.
This is P90X. It's about bringing it. It's about intensity. It's about finding out who you are. It's about finding out if you can get in the best shape of your life.
With P90X, he wanted to improve himself physically. He wanted more endurance. He wanted to become stronger and more fit.
He didn't drink alcohol, didn't do drugs or anything like that, but he was probably still sitting on the couch eating pizza.
He just wanted to prove to himself that he could do something that wasn't easy and persevered, and I think that was the main thing, that he just wanted to set a tough goal and he'd get it done, and he did it.
He did P90X not just for 90 days, he did 180 days.
I think it had to do with the relationship with wrestling and the relationship with Ree, maybe.
He was going through a hard time and he needed to channel all his energy towards something else to heal, to move on, to get his mind off of the stressful situations in his life at the time.
Something about Evan, like the weeks leading up to it, you knew that he was ready for his life to change. He was ready for his life to change, and that's what happened. He was like, I'm going to do this. I'm going to change my life. And he fully committed to it. It was amazing to watch.
Evan got into Beyond Wrestling through Jason Michael Brewer.
I begged a promoter to get Evan into Beyond Wrestling, you know, and they were like, no, this guy sucks, you know.
Jason came to me and said, hey, my friend Evan is a great wrestler, and I think that he would really flourish in an environment like Beyond Wrestling.
So it created this environment where if I were to go to Chris Angel and show him a magic trick, it's got to be a crazy magic trick that like is unreal for him to really appreciate the skill that I have. That was the challenge that Beyond Wrestling did. It was wrestlers wrestling for other wrestlers, so you better bring your A game if you're going to be wrestling in front of arguably the best unknown guys in the country.
I said, this is one of my best friends in the world. He's going to be the greatest. Jarek 120 and Beyond Wrestling is going to be the greatest. And he had the worst match I've ever seen in my life. So then I had to explain that.
And I remember Evan and Aiden Hollis doing a hardcore match, which we had never done before. And I don't know, one of them was bleeding, both of them were bleeding. It's footage that never saw the light of day. It's kind of one of those situations where it's like, all right, like, cool. Like, these guys just wasted our time.
And I had to beg for him to come back again, but eventually he did come back again and he kills it because he's Evan. So there you go. But that's how we got him, to be honest.
Oh my god, it's so hot today.
Oh, hey guys, pretty hot for a scorcher today, am I right? Jesus Christ, if only oh good, sweet, some suntan lotion. I love it.
Do you guys need your backs done? Or your upper thighs?
Is this real life?
I seriously feel like we're being punked right now. I'm not even joking here.
You guys come here often? Oh.
This phone is one of hundreds, so I want you to have it.
I'll just waste it on charity or something. Get out of here.
Please, give it to charity.
Isn't this guy great? Oh my god.
Oh,
isn't this guy great?
Make him look good. I get it.
It's not working out, buddy.
Dude, you look like you have a condom on you. I need one right now.
I have one, but it's a Magnum. Is that okay?
Oh, shoot. I sorry. I can't fit that on.
I always stay protected. Well, feel bad for the guy, but what can he do?
I'll be honest. I'm one of the few guys who actually can fit in one of those Magnums.
It can't be. I don't wear condoms.
Ooh. You are so funny. Do you want to come take a shower with us girls?
Yeah, can I watch?
Oh my god, that just happens every time. Guys, can I just come to the beach for 5 freaking minutes and not get hit on by beautiful women?
Don't you hate when that happens? Happens to me all the time. So what are you guys doing later tonight?
Hey. By the way, tonight, round 2 in the hills. Remember last night?
Oh yeah!
Yeah, Oprah's gonna be there. She's giving away free anything we want.
Anything we want, you guys. Oprah.
She's a pretty good chef. I don't know if you guys know. I haven't seen Oprah in like 6 months.
Do you guys want to go to the party?
No, I'm good.
Are you guys coming to the party? Oprah's giving away free everything.
Anything you want.
Please tell me this is a video.
Or a joke.
Beer? Yeah. I gave that money to charity. They must not like Magnum condoms.
Before I moved out to California, my goal was to move out to California. But after writing it a few times, it eventually evolved to move out to California by this date in April with this much money and live with these guys and be working this job. The more specific, the more detailed, the more on path, on course you'll be. And I achieved that goal. The more specific, the better. Everything in this room, this microphone, these cameras that are filming, the glasses that you may be wearing, the stays that we're standing, the lights above us, the clothes on your backs, everything just started as an idea, as a thought. Thoughts create reality.
What are you going to do if you don't have a goal? You're just sitting around, you're doing nothing. You know, what am I going to do today? I don't know. You have to have some sort of purpose.
When you accomplish one of your goals, you can go out and celebrate. You know, it's like patting yourself on the back, rewarding yourself for completing something. If you don't have goals, you know, what are you going to celebrate when you hit it? Like, what are you going to work towards? What are you going to be happy with? You know, it's like a, it's almost like a measure of happiness too.
When you say, I like to do this, or I'm going to do this, it's just, it's an idea in the back of your head. When you write it down, it really reinforces it, makes it more real because it's physical.
They say that people who write down their goals and actually verbalize and make them known are like 85% more likely to achieve them.
I wanted to ask you something. Is wrestling real or fake?
It's real to me. I mean, is magic real or is it fake?
That's really good.
Why do you do magic?
Because I love it.
But it's fake. Why do people watch TV? Why do people go to the movies? Wrestling will always be like way more real to me than magic like ever will.
That's something that he's been passionate about ever since he was a little kid. It was a phase I thought he was going to grow out of, and I kept waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting some more, and he never grew out of that phase. Whereas magic, he got into that and that waned, and then he got back into it, but the wrestling never subsided. The passion never subsided for wrestling.
I can definitely see people thinking that magic is number one now, but I feel like wrestling will always be number one in his heart.
They're both performance-based. They're both very theatrical, and that's probably why Evan excels at both of them.
I definitely get the sense that he really loves magic, but it's not nearly as much as the love he has for wrestling.
Magic to Evan is, that's a hobby. That's just something he likes doing. But he never once said, I'm going to be a magician when I grow up.
I never heard Evan talk really about being the world's, the great magician of the world, but I have heard him talk about being a WWE superstar and wanting that and having that as one of his goals.
He might end up doing professional magic, but it's still going to be the side job.
Evan almost takes magic as a joke. We like to make fun of it a lot. You know, magic isn't real, magic is stupid, magic is lame, blah, blah, blah. But I've never, ever once heard him say, wrestling is lame, wrestling is stupid, wrestling is fake, wrestling is gay, wrestling is whatever. Never, ever have I heard that come out of his mouth.
It just depends on the grand scheme. I guess the grand scheme is wrestling. So anything Evan really does, which is magic in this case, is a platform onto the biggest goal, which has always been wrestling, honestly.
He kind of commingled them at one point. I mean, he turned into this character in wrestling, Jarek 120, with cards. I mean, he did card tricks. He's a wrestler who does magic.
He can't shake one habit to just do the other. He's good at working with both.
You know, he has definitely a devoted audience to magic, and you know, I think he looks at it more of a way to, you know, kind of fund his wrestling endeavors while still building a skill that he cares about.
He gets the best of both worlds. He gets to do his like favorite hobby to lead into his absolute favorite thing, you know, and his goal, his career goal and his dream.
You know, I wouldn't be surprised if bigger opportunities do come up, and then how disturbed reality will have to take a secondary role. I don't know, someday we might stop seeing Evan performing. It'd be a sad day, but it's probably coming.
See, that's why Evan's a special guy, because he sees the biggest picture. He sees the way bigger picture, and he knows that this will just get more eyes on independent wrestling, and this will get more eyes on him. You get casual people who aren't really into wrestling to check it out, and they realize, wow, this is an art form. This is just like magic. This is just as entertaining.
You can get away with so much physical abuse in wrestling that you can't get away with in the real world. Growing up, I just had a lot of built-up rage and anger, I think, and wrestling was the only thing that I had to let out my frustration. Where else can you hit someone else in the face with a steel chair and get away with it?
This story about Kevin and Evan. It's a good story.
This was in 10th grade. Evan and I were sophomores at Eisenhower High School.
So we're in a pep assembly one day, and I'm sitting next to my best friend at the time, Eric Davis.
Kevin was a big shot, one of the Shelby kids when we merged into Eisenhower, who wanted to get his name out there as a badass.
and gotten a couple fights with kids.
Before I even met Kevin, I had heard about his reputation, that he's a badass and he gets in fights and he hurts people and he, you know, nothing will stop him from getting in a fight with another kid. But I had never seen Kevin before. I didn't know what he looked like. I only heard of him. So we're in a pep assembly one day, and me and Eric are just having fun, being kids, acting out, and screaming.
Well, I mean, we were all into it, but Evan's voice with it was way funnier. We would scream things in the hall, especially Evan.
We would scream things like, "I've got a gun," and "detonate the bomb."
We were being obnoxious, as usual, at the pep assembly, trying to be heard over people talking on the mics or whatever was going on. And then, so Kevin kept telling us to shut up.
He said, like, "If you scream one more time, like, I'm gonna beat the shit out of you." So that's when I looked over and I went.
I'm just like, whoa. Like, what did you just do?
I'm gonna tell you, Kevin did not appreciate this.
That was fantastic.
It just was like this spray cloud across this kid that is like a known fighter and kind of crazy, hard ass that loves starting shit with people.
Then Kevin's like, "Did you just spit at me? Did you just spit on me? Do it again.
Do it again. Do it again."
And that is like Jim Carrey in Ace Ventura. Evan starts.
And he's looking at me dead in the eyes as I'm doing this. That's when Eric stops me. He's like, "No, don't do it.
Evan, stop, stop. Evan, don't." Because I had heard of the reputation of him, but Evan didn't care.
Because in wrestling, they spit on people. And so I'm sure that to some extent, that's more okay to Evan than it is to the average person.
Clean that up for me, thanks.
Oh my God, dude.
So Kevin basically put his name out there and told him he was done, and there was gonna be a big meeting at the, or a fight in the neighborhood, right at Evan's house.
And then Evan went to me asking for advice on if he should fight him, and if he does fight him, how should he beat him? And he asked me because a year prior, me and Kevin got into a bit of a fight, and I won until the end when I lost pretty bad. I went to the hospital, so that was fun. It didn't even hurt, though.
Of course, Evan being my friend, I was down to protect him no matter what, in case Kevin brought his posse of Shelby kids with him.
Kevin was supposed to come to Evan's house, and they were gonna fight, like have a serious fight, and I actually went to Evan's house.
When I finally pulled up, came flying down the street, there was about 30 to 40 kids walking around, just kind of standing across the street awkwardly waiting for something to happen. I pulled in the driveway and opened my trunk and started handing out weapons and bats and stuff, ready for this to go down.
Everyone knew that we were gonna fight after school. Even the teachers. The teachers went to the principal, principal went to Kevin's parents.
We found out that Kevin wasn't gonna show up, said it wasn't worth it because he couldn't get in trouble again, otherwise he'd go to jail.
Me and Kevin aren't like friends, but we're not like enemies with each other anymore. Now that I mentioned that, that's another thing. Like when I first met Joe Nash, like we hated each other.
He would kind of write his journals about me and how ugly I was and how I had no friends. So then I would listen to his conversations with people he would talk to. And you always talk about movies. I would run home and I'd go through like a bunch of magazines and try and find reviews of the movies he liked and find the most negative review of those movies. And then I would cut them out and then I'd bring them to class and give them to him and say, "Oh, you want to be a filmmaker, you should get better taste in what you watch, buddy."
Now we're best friends. Here's a game that me and Joe used to play when we were younger. It'd be like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The people who are actually hurting you the most, I don't know, you might be able to relate with them a lot. Have you ever kissed in the rain?
Yes.
No.
Does that make you sad?
No, yeah,
not
sad.
Happy about that one? If you were given the opportunity to like kiss in the rain, would you?
It's about to rain, isn't it?
You would kiss in the rain again?
Yes.
You haven't yet.
Right? I would really want to.
Okay. Do it like that.
It just happened.
Well, you said you would.
You won't.
Thank you.
kiss you on the cheek in the rain.
You want to keep going until the rain goes out, or?
If you want, sure.
I met Evan through YouTube. I would watch his videos and I was a fan. I emailed Evan, I let him know that I was a cinematographer and that I was going down to VidCon, and that if he'd let me crash with him, I would fly him out to New York City and film some videos for him. Evan was like, yeah, come on down. I knew him as Jarek. I didn't know his name was Evan. I didn't know any of that. He prefers to be called Jarek by his fans. You wouldn't call Chris Angel by his real name. His name is Chris Angel, you know, and you wouldn't call Rihanna by her real name. Her name is Rihanna.
I've named him Evan, and Jarek is just another personality that I choose not to know, because in my mind it might be giving away a piece of my baby that I don't want to give away.
The name Jarek120 came from when I was younger. I was always into filmmaking and video editing. When I was 9 years old, I wrote a script for a movie, and the movie was called Doomsday. And in Doomsday, I was going to play the lead character, naturally. And I needed a name for the character. There's this Mortal Kombat video game that was out for the PlayStation. There's a character in there, his name was Jarek. Just Jarek, no last name. And I was just like, man, that's a really interesting, unique name. So I had that be the character for the Doomsday movie that I was gonna play. And the movie didn't end up getting made, so I used Jarek as my wrestling name. The 120 came a year later, but people don't even seem to really care about the name. People are still wondering about the mystery behind the number.
What does 120 mean?
I really couldn't tell you.
He's told me that, you know, it does mean something, but he like doesn't want to tell me what it means yet.
Oh my gosh, I know this.
120. Well, it's a Bible verse, probably.
I know that has, man, I don't fucking know.
I still don't even know what the hell it means.
I have no clue.
He came up with that when he was a wee little lad.
I was on a 40-day road trip with this guy, and I asked nearly every day, you know, when are you going to tell me what 120 means? Just tell me what 120 means. Never. He won't budge. I have no idea.
I don't know what 120 means. I don't care what 120 means. I don't even know if my brother knows what 120 means.
It could just been a number that he chose because it sounded cool and then he gave meaning to later.
Maybe the month, January 20th.
He'll never tell me. He's always saying it's important and it's special and it's none of our business.
It has to be related with, like, Stone Cold Steve Austin.
I think Evan's just a mark for Stone Cold Steve Austin.
You know, going back to the wrestling roots, we all know
Austin 316 says, I just whipped your ass.
Still to this day, he keeps the 120 thing a secret.
I think there's a chance it means nothing and he's just messing with us.
Evan's the kind of guy that would just make some shit up just so he could be like, what do you think it is? And you'll never know, and he'll just be like, I didn't really think of anything. It's really nothing. It's just to make you think. That's some shit Evan would do.
I don't plan on ever wanting to know because it would take the whole mystique behind it.
It's a secret that we'll never find out. Only Evan knows.
I need to know.
Gonzales.
I would start ringing the bell to get some people out here to try and stop this. This is why we didn't want Chris Dickinson here.
Shut up, or I'm coming down there to fuck you up right now.
Chris Dickinson is a professional wrestler from the New York area who's been wrestling for a few years now. He's known for his martial arts background.
Evan told me a few years ago, I mean, when he first issued the challenge, that Dickinson is somebody that inspired him.
That's kind of been Evan's motif over the last couple of years, me getting to know him. It's kind of been like, you know, follow what inspires you, you know, chase that.
I think that when Evan saw what Chris Dickinson was capable of, I think that Evan wanted to emulate it.
Chris Dickinson really connected with him through the performance art of wrestling. And I think Evan sees this as a personal challenge for him.
And it's one thing to be paired up with Dickinson. It's another thing to say, I want to wrestle you. Because Dickinson knows his reputation, and all of a sudden it's like, well, the expectations here is that this guy wants to test himself. He wants to see how tough he is against me.
Chris seems to have the reputation that he is a bit unstable, and that he's a bit wild in his matches. And he's actually, in the past, has caused people to become injured because of how devastating his strikes can be.
Dickinson's brutal. There's no way around it. He is an ass kicker through and through. And, you know, I'm worried in what may be in the case of Evan. I wouldn't want to be in the ring with Chris Dickinson. And if I was a professional athlete and trained, I would not want to challenge Chris Dickinson. End of story.
When you're an internet personality and you're putting yourself out there in front of potentially millions of people, there's only so much of a side of you that they're going to see. Is there negative sides of Evan that his fan base doesn't know about?
He's completely drug and alcohol free. I've never in my life seen him drink any alcohol or do any kind of drugs.
I bet you people on YouTube think that he's never drank before in the ass, so let's be for real.
Heads up, everybody. Evan drinks. Oh, that's crazy.
Oh! Evan's drunk. Oh. Evan's drunk,
Troy,
just to let you know.
poor Joe.
Dude! Once in a while, just like every other respectable adult that's out there, Evan will throw a couple back from what I've seen lately.
You know, you grow as a person. It's hard to, when you're 14 years old, you don't know how the hell you're going to feel when you're 22 years old.
The Cloyd family has kind of a history of smoking cigarettes and alcohol a little bit, and I thought it was a really bad habit. I knew that the Cloyds have an addictive personality like that. So I figured if I started drinking or smoking, then I would probably like it. And I wasn't ready to like it.
So you're just mad.
Mad at what?
You don't roll slides and wear black socks. I'm starting to kick in that, like, I'm not okay.
Why? Drink water. Evan, worst case scenario, you die. That's absolute worst case scenario.
I think that if anyone could get out of that mental state of having that like addiction, it would be Evan. Although he hasn't really gotten out of his mental state of his addiction for women, so I don't know.
Evan loves to flirt.
Me and my friend had this, we were both talking to this girl that we liked, and we were kind of like, okay, let's just talk to her and see who she's into. And whoever she goes for, you know, the other person will just be like, okay, she's yours. And then Evan just swooped in and kind of started showing her magic and kind of like took her from us a little bit. And we kind of both looked at each other like, did he really just do that? But really the one big personality flaw that I've seen in Evan is just being really selfish.
I feel very like I need attention right now in the most like sexual way, so it just feels really weird.
Mainly pertains to bro code stuff, like, which is kind of funny because it's not that big of a deal. But at the same time, it's like, yo, it's the bro code. I mean, you gotta know it.
I was on the road with him for 40 days and I got to see a firsthand account of the way he treats women, which isn't necessarily bad, it's just, he has a tendency to lead women on, make them expect more than what they're gonna get. He's definitely someone who makes girls think that he's boyfriend material when really he just wants to sleep with them, or he just wants them right then, right now. You know, he just likes to have fun with women and he likes to treat them right. He likes to treat them how he thinks they want to be treated, but it ends up hurting them more so than anything.
I imagine if he had the opportunity, he would have relations with my sister. And I imagine if he had the opportunity, he would have sex with every one of his friends' sisters.
Beffrey, where's your sister?
Chicago.
Chicago?
It's too far away.
Tell her to come here so we can hold her hand. And we're all telling Beffrey that we wanted to do her because it makes him feel uncomfortable for some reason.
I don't think it's really necessary to focus on the negatives. I think Evan is the type of guy to take a step back, examine his life, examine what's negative about him or his personality or his situation, and he's willing to work at it. And to me, that's the most important thing.
I always looked at him as kind of like my son too, and you tend to overlook those types of things, you know, and you just look at him with love and you just say, hey, that's my guy right there.
My mentor, David D'Angelo, I heard him tell of a story of how man is like a captain of a ship, and he's on his boat and he's going across the ocean. You know, he's on his path. He needs to get somewhere. He has a destination. He has he's on his path. And a woman, all women are the ocean. You know, they'll crash into the boat and they'll rock, and they're going to do everything they can to knock you off your path. And you, as the captain, have to, you know, ride on and stay focused to the task at hand. How Mother Nature or women try to knock you off your course.
He likes his women, so they can play around with his mind and tease him and taunt him, and I'd say that's part of the him being broken down part, really.
The whole female species definitely screws with Evan a little bit, or a lot.
I think that that's almost any guy's greatest weakness, though, in my opinion.
It's the only time that I've seen him get, like, allow himself to fall apart.
When he gives his heart, it's a huge deal. And when it gets broken, he's devastated by it, and he has a hard time moving on. But so, in essence, it's a double-edged sword. That's his greatest strength, but it's also his greatest weakness. If he's emotionally attached to someone or something and it doesn't go the way he wants it to or the way he predicted it would go, it can bring him down for a while.
It's a tough thing for anybody to get over, but I definitely think that for the fact that Evan is so strong with everything else and his mentality that, like, it's pretty crazy how powerfully females affect him, and love and all that nonsense. That a broken heart
is blind. I'm probably gonna take a lot of punishment in this match.
The best thing to do is get him back.
Get him back?
Get him back. You got to use some real fight techniques. You know, sometimes you have to do that to stay safe. It's not always about size. It's not. If size mattered, the elephant would be the king of the jungle.
A really good piece of advice that I'd recommend everyone to do, that was recommended for me to do, is go to your closest friends, your most loved family, the people that know you better than anyone, and ask them, what do you see in me that I don't see in me?
I see in you somebody that really feels like they need to prove themselves by doing a bunch of different things. And I think that's great. But what I think that you don't see in yourself is that you don't need to prove yourself.
And it'd be nice to be around Evan that isn't looking to entertain people, that's just looking to chill back and relax.
I don't think you realize how fun you are to be with, just like a hangout. Because I know you're super fun.
I see that you just have that little bit of flair still of like the inner child sometimes. That you check you're following certain rules that someone else set forth when you can make your own and follow that and be more successful that way. More genuine.
Take over any avenue of interest that.
Honestly, I think that is a quality among stars that is very hard to come by. And yes, I did say star because you are a star.
You gotta be thankful for what you have and don't think about what you don't have yet, because
I believe you have a lot more patience than what you give yourself out to. I know at your age.
I see the sacrifice that you're willing to make without you understanding the sacrifice. Because
kind of a womanizer.
to be honest. I see a man who's always trying to impress the ladies.
I also see a lot of self-doubt and sometimes a lack of confidence, even though he comes off being very confident.
Find out that there's always going to be someone better than you, someone better at wrestling, someone better at magic, someone better at everything, someone's more charming.
Face your problems.
You're not always going to be the one.
You either got too embarrassed or angry with yourself that you did something, but it's important to share how you feel after you did something wrong. After all,
when you're working on something that's important to you, like, you might not be as tolerant with friends or, like,
I think what
considerate to what
he sees
is all about.
These different characters that he manifests in his everyday life. He's the entertainer, wrestler, the motion designer, the charmer. He has all these characters, but what he doesn't see is he's still the kid I met in high school, you know, that, and I feel like he still doesn't see that. He's grown as a person, but, you know, I think he's just so torn between what he wants to do.
You know, I think you have a lot of confidence in yourself, and I think you have, and you know that you have a lot of potential. But in my eyes, you have 1,000% more potential than you really believe that you do. 1,000% more potential as, and I'm not talking in terms of a magician or a filmmaker or an editor or anything like that. I'm talking, I think you have one, you're setting yourself up wonderfully someday to be, you know, a father that I know you could be. And sometimes I see it kind of being pushed off for you and just kind of saying, you know what, I got time for that later. And just don't wait too long, because it's there. And I wish I had done that earlier, because it is something that I really enjoy and I know you'd be great at. And don't forget that.
This is my job, I will not quit it. Pulled me out the depths when I thought that I was finished. Yeah, I question if I could go the distance. That's just the work, regardless of who's listening. Listen. See, I was meant to be a warrior. Fight something amongst me. Leave here victorious. Classroom of kids, or a venue performing. If I'd done it for the money, I'd have been a fucking lawyer. Concrete, vagabond, band telling stories. Humbled by the road, I'm realizing I'm not important. See, life's a beautiful struggle, I record it. Hope it helps you maneuvering through yours. That's why we stay in the lab at night. I've been staring into this pad for over half my life. A true artist won't be satisfied, so I guess that's the sacrifice. And I said, make the money, don't let the money make you. Change the game and let the game change you. I'll forever remain faithful, all my people stay true. I said, make the money, don't let the money make you. Change the game and let the game change you. I'll forever remain faithful, all my people stay true. Forget about the bank, fortune in the mansion. Sitting and tripping, watching myself on a plasma. Yeah, I start slipping when I'm thinking about that stuff. Ego on swole until karma catches that up. I'm my grandma's number one grandson. I lost myself to remember who that was. We start thinking about some kicks, a necklace. What I really need is a job off Craigslist. Take away the .com, name, love, fans, the Twitter followers and the buzz. See, you keep the
the issues, but you take away the drugs. And I had to find out who I really was. Who I really was, and so sick of who I was becoming. Yep, tired of running. Time to look at the man in the mirror until I can learn to love him. Make the money, don't let the money make you change the game, and let the game change you. I'll forever remain faithful. All my people stay true. I said, make the money, don't let the money make you change the game, and let the game change you. I'll forever remain faithful. All my people stay true. In a candy painted lack, watch the videos and get the girls in the back. But if that's what I believe in and the reason that I rap, Uncle Sam is my pimp when he puts me on the track. Of course I want doves in a candy painted lack, watch the videos and get the girls in the back. But if that's what I believe in and the reason that I rap, Uncle Sam is my pimp when he puts me on the track. Make the money, don't let the money make you change the game, don't let the game change you. I'll forever remain faithful, stay true, and I said, make the money, don't let the money make you change the game, don't let the game change you. I'll forever remain faithful, stay true, stay true, stay true. Forget about the fame, I said forget about the fame. I'll forever remain faithful, stay true, stay true, stay true.
We're clogging every toilet in the city. I'm still here, and I'm not giving up. I'm not giving up. I'm still here. I'm still here. I'm still here. I'm still fucking here.
If I really love the magic, why would I reveal it? There's a much deeper purpose to why I do what I do. You know, if your why is big enough, then the what is easy.
We'll be counting stars. Oh, take that money, watch it burn. Sink in the river, the lessons I learned. Take that money, watch it burn. Sink in the river, the lessons I learned. Take that money, watch it burn. Sink in the river, the lessons I learned. Take that money, watch it burn. Sink in the river, the lessons I learned.
Everything that kills me makes me feel alive.
Hey, I've been losing sleep, dreaming about the things that we could be. Baby, I've been praying hard, said no more counting dollars, we'll be counting stars.
You're trying to keep warm. I asked my mom the other day, I was like, Mom, why do we have hair? And she said, you know, I mean, think about it. Why do animals have hair? It's to keep them warm. It's all because of evolution, you know? Guess you're not one for stories, huh?